couldn't do it. Speed with some time, going for a dribble here.
One.
Air dribble, the flick, ooh, and he finds the upper 90.
AJ.
This could be it, actually. AJ, a lot of twists. Wonder, what?
Ooh.
Wonder.
What's going on, everyone? Welcome to another Esports in 30. You know the drill. Today's Rocket League. I'm Brody, and this is Nick. And with the last week of league play done, I am getting stoked for playoffs.
Seriously, man. They've got a weird format this year, but I'm into it. I'm excited. We got to know who's going to go to LAN.
Yeah, dude, Page playoffs, it's going to be weird, but we'll talk about that later, because right now we got to get into it, dude, because we have not only a dope guest Lawler calling in, but some equally dope highlights from the North American Rocket League Championship Series.
Yeah, they're on defense right now, but they were able to stop that first early pressure. Yeah. They won't be able to stop this one.
But Typical comes in quickly, fills in the gap, finds Satyu, finds the shot, a nice save, but here comes more pressure from AXB. Looks for the pass back, winners, and Typical finds the pass. Quickly looking for the shots himself, carries it. He's got a little bit of boost to work with here, gets the fake under one, gets the carry, but Torment, the wall of a defender, gets it away. Now Dustin with the pressure, look at that response. NRG is up by two. He's absolutely insane. Oh, Garrett G with the fake kickoff, the click over the top, make him feel bad.
Up the back wall, he beat all of them, and it might be free for Garrett G. He'll make Squishy miss.
Can he get it off to his teammates? Gets it onto the wall, keeps it trapped against the ball, hits the post, and it goes in from Fireburner. Insane play.
Center ball, AJ. Self pass, centers it. Chance for Wonder, and Wonder gets to it first.
They're really stressing right now and feeling it in this match.
Illusion, oh my goodness, Illusion!
AJ.
This could be it, actually. AJ, a lot of twists, but Wonder, what?
Ooh.
Wonder!
Whenever NRG have scored first, pass to Garrett from Fireburner, what a play! I mean, he just wins cleanly in midfield. The pass to Rizzo's there, it's just good! Cloud9, though, they answer with some pressure, just can't come away with anything yet. But this time, they're finding each other in the middle of the field.
Oh!
Wonder, Squishy Muffins, you are ridiculous! Rizzo around the corner. Forces it back, Chicago shoots, he gets it in, and G2 have put the pressure on.
With G2 slamming the door on Cloud9 and NRG earning two more wins, our top two spots are locked in. As for the rest of the playoff picture, Rogue and Ghost sneak in while Evil Geniuses join Splice out in the cold of relegation. With so many storylines from week five and of course the playoffs to look ahead to, who better to call up than my buddy Adam Lawler Thornton. What's up, my buddy?
What's up, boys? How's it going?
What's happening? All good,
nothing,
man.
Just enjoying the time at home while I can.
That's true. Not much there.
I'll see you again, right?
Yeah, because RLCS is popping still. But let's dive into last week, of course, the last week of league play. We got to talk about NRG sitting at the top looking pretty. You know, it wasn't always super clean, but of course, NRG get that perfect 7-0. Is this the scariest we've now seen them ever?
I think you have to say, yeah. I mean, Justin had an MVP caliber season. Fireburner is playing the most consistent we've seen.
Mm-hmm.
And talking with their coach and everybody else, like, they've worked on bringing a level of consistency to their game to where no matter what the match is, no matter what time it is, it's always going to be a certain level. And then when Justin or Garrett or whoever pops off, it just heightens that even more. So, yeah, I think so. I mean, they're playing the best they've ever played. Their level of consistency is way higher than we've ever seen. And they're undefeated. So what's to argue?
It's not. It's like literally Justin can do anything, I feel.
And it feels like Garrett can do the same right now.
Yeah.
Neither of them can do any wrong.
When Garrett is the least talked about player on your team, you know the team's
that's a good team, yeah. Jesus.
So our other top two team was G2. They kind of were a darker horse for the top two spots until right at the 11th hour. Have you seen them kind of come into their own as the season has gone on?
I'm still not completely sold.
Same.
They're good, don't get me wrong. Like, they're super competitive. It's just for some reason I haven't seen a solidified dominant performance from them yet, and I still would in most cases give the nod over to Cloud9, which has also been struggling, which is kind of weird. But yeah, for G2, like, Chicago I think has definitely proven his worth. We talk about how he has potential to be a top five player in the world, or NA for that matter, and he continues to impress, and he still shows that he's MVP caliber for his team. It's just, where is Rizzo fitting in? And I think that's always the question, is do they want him on defense? Do they want him on offense? I personally prefer him on offense because I like his creativity. I like the ability for him to play aggressive.
So then who falls off offense?
Yeah, the demos and stuff are great when he's there, but at the same time, he shows that he's so solidified on defense that it enables JNaps up front. So I think that's where the issue relies, is I don't think we should give them a certain role. I think they should just interchangeably play each position, allow them to rotate as a cohesive unit, and then just fill in where it's suited. Because look at what it does for NRG. NRG has a bunch of mechanical gifted players that it doesn't matter who plays what role, they'll fill in. So if G2 can kind of keep that mentality as well, and then just feel what feels right is what we'll go with, I think G2 could definitely make a good land run, because I don't think we've seen one in three seasons from them. So
it's kind of like what we've seen from C9, even though they've had some ups and downs. Like C9, it kind of does that too. I mean, like, we've seen Torment now move up on to offense, and and all three of them can kind of play everywhere.
I mean, you have to nowadays, right? Like, in this day and age of Rocket League, no weak link is allowed in order to become a LAN competitive team. You see on the other side of the coin, like, PSG is a prime example. When they play on, they look like a LAN dominant team. Ferris hitting shots, Fruity's playing aggressive, like, everybody can do it all. But when they don't, they fall apart and they get stomped because of how competitive it is at the top level nowadays. So in order for G2 to be competitive, for Cloud9 to be competitive, Cloud9's been able to get away with it, I think. They always have these two players between Squishy and Gimmick that just are super good. But when one plays lackluster, Torment steps up and it's fine. I don't think they can get away with that anymore.
And speaking of not getting away with it, they're kind of, their woes continue. Granted, they had a really, really tough week. They did face NRG and G2. But heading into the playoffs, they're having that rematch against SSG, who also took that that win off them. In terms of that matchup, are you, you're not expecting the same result, I assume? Or you think Cloud9 is going to come into this one with a little bit of a chip on
their
shoulder?
I have literally no concern. I have no concern.
He's like, nah.
Like, they'll be there. SSG, I think, is a good fourth. I think they're a really solid fourth. They've proven themselves as a rival series team promoting and moving up. I think they're the best one we've seen in comparison to, like, FlyQuest and Mouse in previous years. But it's Cloud9. Like, Squishy, Torment, and Gimmick will be at the World Championship without a doubt in my mind.
Fair enough.
Well, I mean, I think that's just kind of a done deal. So why don't we talk about the team they're going to play, SSG. So you think that SSG is going to get knocked down? They, because of the Page playoff, they do have a second life. Yeah. Let's just talk about how they can potentially win in that second match and get into LAN. Because they are the strongest looking team from the rival teams from last season.
Yeah. Yeah, they look great. So obviously, for those that don't know, there is a new Page playoff system implemented into the RLCS. So in the past, it used to be third seed played sixth seed, fourth seed played fifth seed, and then they just moved forward. And if you lost, you were out. The way that we did it now is that the third and fourth seed have a extra life per se, so seeding is even more important. So if they lose that match, they then drop down to play the fifth, sixth seed match, which benefits the players that have shown their worth throughout the season. So that's great. Space Station has put themselves in a really good position, and I don't think it's a free take yet. Like, Ghost is finally figuring their stuff out. You got Illusion and the rest finally communicating, as Lethmere said in his interview last week, that they're finally on the same page, and it shows. Like, they aren't just this team that sits on defense. They clear the ball, they move up with aggression, and they find each other with passes. So I do think Ghost is going to take it over Rogue, just because I haven't seen enough from others other than Krenovi to take that. I think Ghost is going to be a really scary team moving forward. It's just, can they show it consistently, which is always the question for Rocket League, is, are you consistent in your gameplay? So,
yeah, and I mean, for Leth, it's got to feel pretty good delivering kind of on his promise. After the first 2 weeks, he kind of came out very vocally and was like, you know what?
Well, just need to stay off Twitter. Just stay off Twitter.
Like, I mean,
what are you doing?
He made a bold claim saying that they were going to make playoffs, and they did it. And as you said, Illusion seems to be really slotting into the system. And now you said that you think they're going to beat Rogue, but against SSG, to kind of make that land spot, yes, no, maybe?
Coin toss. It's always a coin toss nowadays. Like, when it comes down to predictions in the RLCS nowadays, just flip a coin and whatever you pick is what you get. Like, I think that one's going to probably go the distance. I think it's going to be a really exciting match to see, like, coming down to the wire. It's a best of seven as well, which is different. We haven't seen any of these teams play a best of seven since DreamHack Leipzig. So they did some stuff for, like, Dallas qualifiers, and Valencia qualifiers are coming up too. But it's interesting to see how the tables turn when you're playing seven games instead of five. A little bit more time to adapt. Usually we see it after game three, and we also see it after game five, six. So I'm curious to see how that applies. I haven't seen Space Station play a long series in a while, but usually they're a one-size-fits-all kind of team. They play super aggressive, really fast, aggressive offense with attack and shots, and their accuracy has been their issue. So if they're hitting their shots, then they look great. If they don't, then they're going to have to find a way to bounce back, because Ghost will punish them for that.
talking about finding a way to bounce back, they're going to have to do it in the promo relegation because EG, something fell apart. This is the first time we've seen an international trade in Drip A.
It feels so bad.
I know. And it's, I forgot who mentioned
but he's
it.
He's been
but
the best
like,
performing on the team. I think we both agree. Like, Drip A has been the best performing player on that team. So is it his fault or otherwise?
I might
is
say
another
Classics,
story.
To be honest. I really think
Classics has been consistent. Yeah. I think he's been consistent, but he's never been anything to carry them to that next level. He hasn't been the catalyst that gets them wins, but he hasn't been the problem either.
So is this
I think
a
this
failure?
One, it comes. I don't know if it's a failure. Like, we see it in professional sports all the time where it takes time for a roster to develop when you have a new coach come in or any of that kind of stuff. It takes time for people to develop. So, yeah, they may find themselves in relegation, but look at the talent on that team. You have a player who's gone to LAN how many times with how many different rosters and classics. You've got Kreptegy, who's always been a staple of the community, or a staple, I should say. Not a staple. He's not a horse. And then he is a workhorse, so we'll go with that. But and then you have Drippe, who is considered the best player in OCE at one point, and who is playing pretty well. So there is a lot of talent on the team, and I think the talent alone will be able to carry them over the rival series teams trying to play in. But that's not to discredit them. Like, Birds and the Bees and the other teams that are playing up look do good. Look pretty solid. Mm-hmm. So I think we all agree that there is not a surefire win. It is something you have to work towards, and you know Fireworks is going to put those guys through some sort of gauntlet to make sure they're ready. So
yeah, their coach is going to be on fire.
They just got to figure it out. It's figured out, right? It's super easy.
Figure it out.
Yeah, now, I don't know, man.
Before I move on to EU, I just want to get your thoughts in. Nick, give me your four teams. What are the next two teams going to land? I want to see if Lawler agrees.
Other than
so we always have our top two,
G2 and
G2. Who's filling the next two spots?
Yeah, probably I like Cloud9 and SSG.
Cloud9, SSG, you agree with that?
Yeah, I think our top four seeds are pretty consistent. I just can't give the edge to Ghost yet, but if they're looking hot, like if they come in and they dominate Rogue, watch out. It could be a very big upset. So throwback to Denial days when they came in as four seed.
Sad junior. Wow. Oh, anyways, that's it for NA. We got to move on to EU. So why don't we check out these highlights to get all you guys caught up.
T-Grave back down. K-Dop pops it to himself. Flip reset. Going Whoa. For it, and oh my, K-Dop!
Trying to respond, and we've seen T-Grey in the past. We know what he can do. We know
on
what a lock
the pinch! The pinch from Vitality!
His mark couldn't do it. Speed with some time, going for a dribble here.
One.
Air dribble, the flick, Ooh. And he finds the upper 90!
Ronicky was able to challenge.
What a bump!
Again, I'm missing the bump.
Oh my goodness!
Up, Devo.
Gets it away from Cassio as well. Ronicky now putting it back onto the backboard. He tries to look for a shot, doesn't find a tadpole up to get one more, but the defense double commit opening here for Cassio. Drops it in.
Oh,
Louis falls from the heavens and makes the save.
Very quickly beat the inbound rebound. Here comes Violent Panda with a shot. It's off the bottom corner. Now dribble pulls it in for the follow.
Oh, I thought he got
gets it.
It
in. Violent Panda with a shot. A nice pass play broken up by the defense. And oh my goodness, what a recovery.
Nothing good just yet. Alpha catches this one, has Fruity to beat Alpha 54. They've had a couple of opportunities in the orange hat, but it's been two shots registered on net, and Alpha 54 again, forcing PSG to use a lot of boost. Straight down, can Bluey get there?
Oh, Bluey!
And in Barcelona! Showing their resilience as the shot blocked off the post. Standing was Yukio. It looked like he might have gotten it.
Oh, and they're gonna score.
Speed off the return. No one really able to find a consistent presence in the midfield, but the rebound free off the backboard. Violent Panda, he'll score that. 1-0 for Dignitas.
It came down to the last few games, but Dignitas managed to clutch up and move into the playoffs while FC Barcelona surged into second place. TSM enters the playoffs on a losing streak, and Cooksier and the Bricks are headed for relegation. So much action in Europe to close out league play, so let's start with Dignitas, Lawler. They finally look like they're back in it. I mean, they had a really rough start. You're saying maybe? I think they look like they're kind of back in it.
I mean, for me, Dignitas, I mean, it took them way too long to get to where we expected them to be, and I don't even think they are where we fully expect
well,
them to be.
That's because we put an expectation on them, right? And as we should, being a two-time world champion and having a three-time world champion, but roster change happened, things change, so... Yeah, I think they're back on the upswing. A lot of that, I do want to credit their organization. They've always put a lot of effort in these guys. Printeville has always loved the Rocket League scene and shown the best for this team. So the fact that they were willing to fly these guys out, put them in a house, give them a place to play together next to each other, I think makes a big difference. I know they're doing it again for playoffs, so I think it'll give them that edge. Dignitas is on the upswing, and we know what they can do when their backs are against the wall.
I feel like they're playing like the 4 million IQ right here. They just wanted people to stop hating them. So they're like,
we're
you know
joking
what?
About this on the
we're,
now.
We're gonna do really bad.
We're gonna
so
win
the people
Dream Hacks.
Want us to win again, and then they start winning, and I guarantee you they're gonna win all of LAN. Calling it.
That's a bold prediction.
I don't think so.
Well, and they got to get through TSM first, who's had a pretty rough end to the season. They went from probably one of the best teams we had in Europe to losing like four in a row, and they're now the bottom seed, even below Dignitas. Mm-hmm. So, Lawler, talk to me about that matchup, but also how TSM went from looking pretty good to looking...
falling apart.
Yeah.
It's weird, man. They started great, you know. They were undefeated the first week, and then they go from second place all the way to fifth place in one day, and then the next day they lose two in a row and they go to sixth place. So they're literally our last seed after starting as what we consider the best, or the second best team behind Vitality. So kind of weird. I don't know. It's like Dignitas 2.0. Like, they're just not playing well. Like, there's no excuse for it. A team that we expect greatness out of, they just aren't hitting their shots. They're not playing as a team. They're not rotating well. So I honestly have no answer as to why they're playing like this, because there's no excuse for it. And it sounds really harsh, but like, we set an expectation of you guys because you are really good. You just won a major back in December at E-League against some of the other best competition, and yet we haven't seen anything to solidify that. Metzenars has shown his worth sometimes. Remco's been playing a little lackluster. Ignite hasn't really been showing his dominance on offense, so I think it's a little bit of everything. It's kind of weird. Especially funny, a team, like, that I'm a huge fan of.
I'm pretty sure we talked to Achieves, and at the same time, he said, I don't know.
Like, he was like maybe they're too passive in the midfield, maybe?
I couldn't figure it out either.
I don't know. Like, they're a team that is primarily defensive. Passive in the midfield is something that is nothing new for them. They do like to sit back. And for some teams, that's a good thing. Like, when you have a team that's really aggressive, rather than trying to beat them to the ball, like a Barcelona, that's going to probably beat you anyway, you just enable that. You allow them to do that and sit back, because that allows you to conserve your boost to get into a position to challenge that. And that's something that TSM has always done. Clearly, that's not working right now, so maybe they should change it up. Maybe they should play a little bit more aggressive. And I don't necessarily disagree with that. If Ignite starts inserting himself into the offense and just playing this really aggressive role, the rest should be able to follow into suit and support that. It's what allowed them to win at E-League, where they completely shut down Dignitas and completely crushed Cloud9. So, I don't know. It's weird from TSM. Maybe they need to change it up.
Speaking of, you mentioned Barcelona there for a bit. They just set a record in the RLCS, coming in as the first Rivals team to make it into LAN.
To make it top. Don't make directly to land.
Directly into land. Like that.
They
that is. Now, Nick was pointing out that it's a little bit of cheating.
I mean, you've got a world champion and a DreamHack winner.
How's that their fault? They did it the right way, right? Like, you can't discredit what they've done. They had guaranteed spots in the RLCS. They purposely left the RLCS, went through the open qualifier, qualified, dominated the rival series, come into the RLCS, and then place top two.
Yeah, that's like, true. I mean, the record is the record.
I'm just calling you out.
And like, this is also after Devo looked like crap. Like, he did not look like top tier.
Devo had some motivational issues, right? You know, he wasn't training as hard, but now it's shown that he's got his heart back in
arc.
It.
Yeah.
So
too busy playing arc, man.
Yeah, too busy playing arc.
So we briefly mentioned on Bluey. We now just talked about Devo, but the third member of that team is one of the ones that I think has been the most impressive to myself and Brody and maybe everybody. If for you, in your perspective, Alpha rookie of the season for Europe?
Easily rookie of the season. Yeah. You could even consider him MVP mentions. He has been a solidified rock for the team, super consistent, both as a offensive player and defensive player. Like, it doesn't matter what he's been doing, you know he's not the problem. And that's tough to do. You come into an RLCS season where it is probably the most competitive we've ever seen based upon results and otherwise, and you basically solidify yourself as one of the best teams in the world. That's not easy. And the fact that he does it as a rookie is exemplified even more. So that's great. Like, I definitely give him a nod towards MVP this season. It's hard not to.
Yeah, one thing I thought was really good about his gameplay is that he came in clutch in a lot of situations, and he was making solo plays against great teams when SCB really needed those
wins.
He's
a playmaker.
Exactly, which is not something you see all the time from a rookie.
Yep. No, he's nuts. We got to talk about another team. A team that I'm a little bit of on a question mark of right now is Triple Trouble. Like, these guys, they showed up. They took out Vitality 1 week, and they've been close, even playing against Barcelona. But it's like, I still don't know if they have it in them to be at that top. I feel like they may have hit their cap.
They are the same issue, I think, as a lot. Like, they lack that consistency. Mm-hmm. There's moments where they play up to their competition, they play down to their competition. I speak to it a lot. I think competition breeds excellence. The times that you get to play against teams that are better than you, or ones that you challenge yourself on, the longer the series goes, the better, because these guys learn to adapt and they get more out of it. So that's, I think, what makes the teams like SSG and Triple Trouble so dangerous, is they bring something new. Even though it's not something that's probably the best, it may not be the greatest passing plays or, you know, the most mechanical skill, it is fast, it's aggressive, and it's in your face. And a lot of these teams don't like that, especially when there's a lot of pressure on the line. They play pretty much with no remorse, and that's scary. So when you have teams like this playing a longer series, you're only going to see them get better, and it gets down to the wire. So I think they do have potential to be a top two team in Europe currently. It's just, at what time do we get to see that? You have moments where they beat Vitality. I do think Vitality slacked that week. Vitality is the best team in the world right now, without a doubt in my mind. But SSG and Triple Trouble both have potential for upset.
I might argue NRG in that, but that's for a different time.
That's because you're biased in from North
America. I'm not biased. C9's my favorite team.
You say that, but we all want NRG to win. Don't lie to me, man. Like,
I think Garrett G's earned this one. Deserved, but that's about five times over.
That's another time. We're almost at time for EU, so we do have to talk about the last team that's made huge strides, PSG. Like, they've always been that team that is such a question mark because they get reverse swept so much, but it seems they finally beat their demons.
Yeah, I don't think that's really their story anymore. For me, it's a matter of putting focus on Pharah. He is their captain, solidified, and when he is on, they look so good. When he's hitting his shots, like, just that little bit of extra pressure on target is forcing defenders out, and then allows Chaussette to move through cleanly. Like, I remember back in Season 3, Season 4, we considered Chaussette MVP. He was my MVP, even though he didn't get the pick, because of what he's capable of. And when he's, again, the least talked player on the team, you know something is dangerous, because that means Fruity's inserting himself, and Pharah's landing his shots, so I wish that they would show that on a regular basis, but when the competition is as hard as it is, it's not always that easy or that simple. So I need them to find a way to do that against teams like PSG, because in their, or against teams like Barcelona, because in their recent mashups, you saw it in Barcelona when they played in DreamHack, they went to a 6-minute overtime to decide who won that series, and then they lost to him again in the lower bracket. So I need some solidified results consistently, because no offense to Fruity, he did have a really rough last week. He did not look good in their final week. So finding a way to make sure that it's all the time, not just like once in a great while, is what will bring PSG to that next level. But we've seen their potential. We know what they're capable of. Don't expect them to be a walk in the park. Like, they make a really strong case for third, fourth. They really do. Because TSM's not doing it, so.
Yeah, definitely. Don't expect them to be walking the park, though. Seems to be kind of the story of Europe every time we talk about Europe. Every single team is tough. So let's close the book here. I'll reverse the question that Brody asked me. Brody, who you got for your top four out of Europe?
Top four out of Europe? Well, of course, we got our two that are made in, Vitality, Barca. I'd have to say, it's so weird. Like, I really,
this one's a lot harder than North America.
It's really difficult. I don't think TSM's going to be able to pull it together in time. I feel like Dignitas is going to pull through. I can't see a world without Dignitas. And I think PSG again. I think those guys have what it takes in them to get to it.
You like the veterans?
Yeah. I'm like, again, like, you see someone like Fruity, the energy from a guy like that is just, he just loves that he's even in this. Like, he's like, this is just the coolest thing ever. And that's
he's
such
an old guy, man.
Yeah, it's such a good mentality to have, right? Like, that helps your team out so much.
So based upon what you're saying, right? So that means, does PSG qualify through the uppers to you, or do they drop down and have to play another match against Dig or somebody? Because in that case, because in this case, that means that PSG wins against Triple Trouble right away, which I would probably agree to, which means they go to play Barcelona. Yeah. Triple Trouble then drops down and plays Dig or TSM, in your case, Dig.
Dig, yeah.
Triple Trouble over Dig, like, I could see it.
Possibly, but I have to just go with the gut feeling of Dignitas has a plan. They know what they're doing.
It's weird for them to consider they won't be at LAN. Like, the fact that our second match of that day on Sunday is Dignitas or TSM, one of you doesn't go to LAN, like, That's baffling to me.
No, I've Dignitas is going. They're winning the whole thing. I told you. I already told you the plan.
All right.
200 IQ, man.
Yeah, yeah. Now, I just we got to let you go in a second here, man, but I have one thing I want you to quickly answer here. And a guy online, John, he asked on Reddit, you know, how come a lot of times we see, I'll just paraphrase, a lot of times we see a lot of bad plays, and a lot of times casters seem to, you know, seem light of it instead of calling them out. Now, obviously, he doesn't want you to flame them, but should we not be calling out bad plays? And what's the balance you try to find?
So I made a genuine switch personally about that, probably season 5-ish. I've been very critical of players as of late. I think we are now in our 7th season that we have an expectation that's being set. And when people are not performing to the extent that they should be, we should call them out. I don't think we should flame and degrade them and all that kind of stuff. People obviously have off weeks, but there needs to be a little bit of empathy there. But at the same time, if someone makes a mistake, that should be pointed out. And I agree to it. But at the same time, you also have to understand the big picture. Your job as a commentator is to set the atmosphere or tell the story of these players. So when this person is doing something, you try to give them the benefit of the doubt for multiple reasons. Number one, they're a pro. They probably know better than you. Number two, things happen. We don't know if there's a communication breakdown, and it's hard to speculate. Number three, like, they are representing an org. You want to paint these guys in the best light. It is part of your job to say, like, okay, this player is representing X team, and X team doesn't want us crapping on their player in the middle of thousands of people. So
don't sign
that is
player.
Part of it as well, right? Like, there is part of it. So I am notorious, I think, compared to a lot of people. I am pretty brutally honest when it comes to teams. I read that comment. I know he talked about, like, in relegation, I crapped on Rogue because they looked awful. And I said it straight up. And some people appreciate that. Some people get their feelings hurt and take it too seriously. But at the end of the day, like, it's our job to analyze the situation. And if someone is playing underperformed, then yeah, criticize them by all means. I think they're pros. They're it's the same thing as us. If I do something stupid on broadcast, I expect to get critiqued. You're
it's
in a public
the overall
light.
Picture that you sell. You we may sell the positives, you sell the negative. Overall, we understand what's happening, right? But yeah, exactly. Anyways, that's it. All the time we have, dude. We gotta let you go, but thanks for calling in, and I'll see you in a few days.
Always a pleasure, guys.
All right, Nick. We've got like 2 minutes left here, but we gotta touch on something. I've been hearing you rant, so I'm gonna let you do it. People are reviewing, bomb reviewing Rocket League on Steam.
Yeah, don't do this, guys. Seriously. Like, okay, so it's obviously in reaction to Epic Games buying Rocket League. And people have just been downvoting, posting negative reviews on Rocket League. Don't do this, guys. It's not going to change anything. The deal is done. You're just hurting yourselves, really.
But why not? It shows that I'm really upset about this, and this is how I can get my opinion out.
No.
How else am I supposed to get my opinion out?
I mean, if you really wanted to, if you really wanted to get your opinion out there, you could stop playing Rocket League if you're really that affected. But I see that some of you have got like 10K hours, so I don't think that that's going to happen anytime
soon.
Yeah,
that's the other thing. We've seen so many boycotts. At the same time, this does nothing. Like, there's no, like, just because there's a parent company you don't like buying another company doesn't mean your product's going to change.
They're not even giving it a chance yet. Nothing has happened yet.
That's the thing. Literally nothing has happened. You cannot make any judgments yet at this point. So going and review bombing Rocket League does nothing. And it, like, even and if the game changes, then go and do stuff. But like, I've seen people do this with other games too before, and it's like, what are you accomplishing right now besides showing that you're a little baby? Like, I'm not sure what you can do. Like, there are ways to get around this, like real boycotts. So many people I've seen, they're like, oh, I'm gonna boycott, EA, which I did, right? Like, I did it successfully, but other people are like, I'm gonna do it, but you know, like, microtransactions are okay because I'm not actually paying for the game. That's not how boycotts work.
That's not a boycott.
Right? So, like, at the end of the day, TLDR, if you're really upset about something, what's the best way to go about this?
Well, like I said, A, if you're really unhappy about it, don't play the game and don't support Psyonix and or Epic with your wallet, first of all. And that means not playing. That means not downloading the Epic launcher. That means uninstalling Rocket League and not playing anymore. But, and also, obviously, I mean, don't harass them or anything like that. Don't say bad things. But if you want, but there are outlets for you to express your opinion. Just do it in a way that's constructive.
The game has nothing to do with it. At the end of the day, I know all of you guys are still going to keep playing Rocket League.
It's the truth.
You're not getting away with Rocket League.
We all love Rocket League a bit too much.
You're not getting away with it. Anyways, we are down here. Nick, I know you're hyped for playoffs. I'm hyped for playoffs, and hope you find people at home are too. Tomorrow on the show, it's an FBS doubleheader as Marissa and Zurich will be tackling IEM Sydney and CWL London. Until then, get more squad in your diet by checking out our socials at Squad State. We'll see you later.